And I call on John Swinney to speak to and move the motion. Up to 9 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, I welcome this opportunity to open the debate on the general principles of the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill and thank committees of Parliament for their careful consideration of the provisions of the Bill. President Officer, with the benefit of hindsight, I think we can all agree that our statute book was not sufficient to deal with the circumstances that we faced in March 2020. Members will recall we required two pieces of emergency legislation in a matter of days to provide the legislative ability to handle the pandemic. This bill, if passed, will put in place legislation that we consider to be necessary, proportionate and appropriate to ensure we can respond in future where circumstances require it. The measures in the bill fall into three broad categories: powers to counter future public health threats, the embedding of practical public service reforms that have demonstrated their value irrespective of the public health position, and extended temporary measures to help manage the impact of COVID, specifically on the Scottish justice system. The latter two categories have largely been endorsed in the scrutiny to date, but the first has generated significant difference of opinion, and my speech will focus mostly on that issue this afternoon. For the most part, the measures in the bill across all categories already exist in temporary legislation, but will expire in September. They update and equip the statute book in sensible and appropriate ways based on learning lessons from the pandemic. The measures were consulted on as a coherent package in a full 12-week public consultation that took place between August and November last year, and the measures in the bill collectively support the government's recovery strategy from COVID and the recently updated COVID strategic framework. I am pleased that the lead committee has, having regard to the other scrutiny committee's reports, endorsed the general principles of the bill and has recognised that it is appropriate to equip the statute book with powers to counter future public health threats. Of course.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. This pandemic caught us by surprise. That's in their nature. The next pandemic will catch us by surprise as well. We can't legislate for that now. We can do preparation, for sure. We can have our civil servants draft up contingencies. But is it really necessary to legislate now to retain those draconian powers that the government handed itself at the start of this one?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would encourage Alex Cole-Hamilton to listen to the arguments I'm going to develop during my opening speech, but I don't accept the point that there is material that we do not need to legislate for to enable for us to prepare for future pandemics, because we can foresee a lot of what will emerge in that respect. I and my ministerial colleagues have read with interest the recommendations contained in the various committees' Stage 1 reports. While there are some recommendations that we are not persuaded are necessary, there are places where we can agree change may be needed and are now actively considering appropriate amendments at Stage 2. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee report recommended that an explanation of urgency requirement be added where the made affirmative procedure is used for powers taken in the bill. I agree that that is appropriate to explain why regulations require to be made urgently, and therefore the Government will bring forward an amendment at Stage 2 to this effect. I can also confirm that my officials are working with parliamentary counterparts to develop a protocol for an expedited draft affirmative procedure in appropriate cases. In relation to the proposed powers to modify primary legislation through future public health protection regulations, the so-called Henry VIII powers, I remain of the view that this power is appropriate and is already subject to significant safeguards. However, having considered the views of members, we will bring forward amendments at Stage 2 to add the further restriction that that power will only be available where ministers make regulations under the draft affirmative procedure. This would mean that parliamentary approval must be in place before any modification to primary legislation takes place. Of course.
Murdo Fraser.
Cabinet Secretary, for giving way, and I'm grateful to him for the concessions he's just announced on the Henry VIII powers, which the committee identified as one of the key areas of concern. The Cabinet Secretary has said consistently that what the government is trying to do here is just reflect the legislation south of the border that already exists. But would he accept that these Henry VIII powers do not exist in the equivalent legislation in England and Wales?
Cabinet Secretary.
My view is that they do, but they require to be put in place with the necessary safeguards, which is what I'm addressing today. And I've got, if Mr Fraser thinks that there's been ground given already, I encourage him to be patient for what more is to come. I want to take some time to address the proposal that has developed in stage one scrutiny that some key powers be taken out of the bill and held, and quotes, held in reserve or quotes, kept on the shelf for emergency enactment at a future point. I acknowledge the concerns that are behind this proposal, and I accept that the bill provisions as introduced did not strike the right balance between having the legislative framework we need and the necessary level of parliamentary oversight. There are three points that need to be considered in this respect. The first is, I believe there remains a clear and compelling argument for ministers to have the public health protection and educational continuity powers that are placed in parts 1 and 2 of the bill. The statute book is currently not complete, and that requires legislative action now. The public health protections would allow ministers not only to make regulations in a time of emergency, such as, in the most extreme circumstances, to impose a national lockdown as we had to do to combat COVID, but also to make regulations in peacetime for future, to prepare for future threats, which is my point to Mr Cole Hamilton. I'm thinking here of standing preparedness measures such as those which have been put in place in England and Wales since 2010. If Mr Green would forgive me, I've got quite a lot of material I need to get on the record. The second point I recognise is the need for future action by ministers to be grounded in evidence. Throughout the COVID pandemic, decision-making was guided by the advice of our Chief Medical Officer and other advisers, and members saw that most recently when key scientific evidence concerning the potential impacts of the Omicron variant was provided to Parliament in December. And thirdly, I have acknowledged there is a need to involve Parliament more effectively than originally proposed in decision-making. The need for swift and effective action in the event of a future public health threat needs to be balanced by proper parliamentary scrutiny. Drawing these three points together, I consider that the most appropriate approach is to enact the necessary legislative framework now, but to insert a mechanism that requires Parliament to authorise the use of such powers in a specific circumstance. We need the ability to coordinate a national public health response which could supplement local action, which was already possible under existing public health legislation, and we need adequate parliamentary oversight. To ensure that necessary parliamentary oversight is in place, the Government will bring forward amendments to introduce a gateway vote mechanism, which would mean that key aspects of the public health protection and educational continuity powers would only have effect if a parliamentary vote on a formal government declaration is held and approved. This would allow the Parliament to enact these powers with the confidence that lockdown, school closure and other emergency response measures could only be imposed in the event of a future public health threat in an emergency situation if the Parliament has so authorised. I do not consider that the standing preparedness measures would be subject to the gateway control. These would be resilience preparations that would be the subject of regulations under the draft affirmative procedure and would be approved by Parliament before they are enacted. They cannot objectively be described as emergency measures. This capability is an important measure to our response toolkit. The powers to make such measures have not been available in Scotland, as they have been in England and Wales, and the Bill already sets out sufficient safeguards for their use, including, of course, parliamentary approval under the draft affirmative procedure. Consideration will also need to be given to exceptional circumstances where Parliament cannot meet, for example, when it has been dissolved in the pre-election period. I will provide more details to members at stage two for scrutiny at that point. Building on the practices with which we have become familiar through the COVID pandemic and the need I have identified for an appropriate evidence base, the Government declaration underpinning these issues would rely upon the advice of the Chief Medical Officer.
Cabinet Secretary, I must ask that you conclude.
In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I hope the amendments that I have announced this afternoon, together with the further points that were made in the Stage 1 report in relation to the Henry VIII powers and the introduction of a gateway provision, demonstrate the willingness of the Government to listen to Parliament as we bring forward necessary measures that are required to ensure we have adequate protection in place for a future pandemic, but which crucially pay respect and observe the importance of parliamentary accountability. I move that Parliament endorses the general principles of the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill.
Thank you. I now call on Siobhan Brown to speak on behalf of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in this debate on behalf of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee. And firstly, I'd like to put on the record the committee's thanks for the hard work and the support of our clerking team. I will start by providing an overview on how the bill has been scrutinised at Stage 1 before outlining the committee's key findings in its Stage 1 report. The wide-ranging policy areas engaged by this bill arguably reflects the profound impact that COVID-19 has had on our society and our economy. As we enter the recovery phase of the pandemic and much of the temporary coronavirus legislation expires, this bill invites us to consider what lessons we have learnt since 2020 and what measures should be retained to ensure we can respond to future public health threats effectively and proportionally in the future. We worked with relevant subject committees to ensure that this bill received thorough and informed scrutiny to answer this question, and I'm grateful to the Education, Children and Young People Committee, the Criminal Justice Committee and the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee for working jointly with our committee to scrutinise this bill. I'm pleased that the conveners of these committees will take part in the debate today, and I will therefore focus my contribution on the provisions that our committee scrutinised in Part 1 and Part 3 of the bill. Part 1 contains powers to coordinate a national response to a public health threat. These powers form the backbone of the COVID-19 response, and we've broadened by this bill to enable Scottish ministers to respond to any infectious disease or biological or chemical contamination in the future. We don't often consider legislation that has had such a profound and direct impact on all our constituents, and I think this is reflected in the high response rate we received in our consultation. We received over 3,900 responses to our survey and nearly 100 written submissions. A clear majority of the responses to the short survey were opposed to the bill. For the provisions in Part 1, for example, more than 80% of responses argued against making these permanent. Whilst the responses to our survey do not reflect a representative sample of the population's views, they do highlight that there is a significant public interest in the bill. The committee was therefore keen to reflect on how the powers were used in response to COVID-19 and whether they provide the right framework for dealing with a future threat. I thought it was interesting that one expert in public health drew an analogy with preparations for war, noting that military planners are always planning for the previous war and not the next war. So when we looked into the legislative template that was being used, we found that these provisions implement the World Health Organization's international standards for public health legislation. Now, this is an important point. This framework was developed internationally in response to the experience of SARS, and similar powers have been in place in England and Wales since 2008. Part 1 largely mirrors the English and Welsh legislation, but includes some substantive differences. The key difference we focused on was the inclusion of the Henry VIII powers, which are found in Part 1 and in Part 6. These powers would enable the Scottish ministers to amend any legislation for the purpose related to the scope of the bill. The committee noted that there were alternative approaches to the inclusion of the Henry VIII powers in the bill. These provisions could be to remove it entirely and brought forward an emergency legislation in the future if required. Another approach would be to delay the commencement of these provisions until a public health emergency arises and to give Parliament a role in scrutinising the decision to commence the powers in those circumstances. The committee did not come to a consensus on this matter, but I welcome that the Scottish Government have considered this, and I welcome the update from the Deputy First Minister in the opening speech. Overall, some members of the committee agreed with the general purpose of the provisions in Part 1, Chapter 1, which is to enable Scottish ministers to coordinate a national response to future health threats. Other members of the committee considered that the Scottish Government had not made a sufficient case on why the powers should be made permanent. Instead, those members considered that these powers could be brought forward quickly under primary legislation if required in the future. But there are many aspects of the bill where the committee were in agreement. We all agreed that the role of Parliament in a public health emergency is paramount, notwithstanding the challenges faced by government in responding to these kind of threats. Presiding Officer, this is why we've argued that part one of the bill could be strengthened, including in relation to the use of the made affirmative procedure. On this, we're in agreement with the DPLR committee, and my colleague, Mr. McMillan, is contributing in this debate, so I'll leave it to him to explain these recommendations in more detail during his contribution. The COVID-19 Recovery Committee would also like to see some of the best practice developed between Parliament and Government reflected in this bill, such as the reporting requirements that were contained in the temporary COVID-19 legislation, and a requirement that the reviews of the use of the legislation be reported to Parliament. We've also asked that the Government to consider amending the bill to require that an appeals process is created if the requirement to use the powers in Part 1 is triggered in the future. I note that the Government has indicated that it does not support these recommendations, and we may return to the reasons for and against these recommendations in this debate. Presiding Officer, I will conclude by commenting on Part 3 of the bill. The non-justice-related measures in Part 3 are largely aimed at ensuring our public services can be delivered remotely. This is intended to ensure that our public services are more resilient to any disruption in the delivery of in-person services. The committee agreed with the general principles of these provisions, but we have argued that the bill should also include a requirement for local authorities to provide a choice between remote and in-person services. We've also asked the Scottish Government to give consideration, further consideration, to how it's going to work with local authorities and the third sector to ensure that there is sufficient and appropriate support available to users of online services, particularly those who are digitally excluded. I welcome the Scottish Government's agreement in its response to our report that we cannot disadvantage those who do not or cannot access public services online. The bill also does deal with the nomination of a named person under the Mental Health Act. We consider that the bill could be strengthened by requiring a nominated person to confirm they have read and understood the guidance about their role when they take it on. We've also recommended that more needs to be done to ensure that the people take up this important safeguard, and I note that the Scottish Government intends to take forward some of our recommendations in guidance. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the committee recommends that the Parliament approves the general principles of this bill, and this decision did come to by a vote. I look forward to hearing more detail on the Scottish Government's response to our report in this debate. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Audrey Nicholl to speak on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to open in this afternoon's debate on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee. The Criminal Justice Committee has been a secondary committee on the bill and has considered its justice provisions. And at the outset, I want to thank the witnesses who took the time to give evidence on the bill. Their views have helped shape our views on the proposal, and I also want to thank our committee clerking team for their support in leading us through the Stage 1 process and producing our Stage 1 report. The justice provisions in the bill can be divided into two types of measures, permanent and temporary. The permanent changes are ones put in place during the pandemic, but which the Scottish Government has decided are worthy of retaining on a permanent basis. Generally speaking, they attracted limited comments and were fairly non-contentious. For example, the bill proposes the establishment of a permanent system whereby interim payments can be made to lawyers for legal aid work. However, the temporary justice measures in the bill attracted more interest. The bill sets out what temporary means in practice. All the temporary justice measures will expire on the 30th of November 2023 unless an extension is agreed by statutory instrument, and the temporary measures cannot be extended beyond the 30th of November 2025. So I want to briefly highlight four of these temporary justice measures. First, the bill proposes to extend the current temporary measures that supported electronic court business during the pandemic. Sometimes this has been referred to as virtual courts or virtual trials. The committee heard from some in the justice sector who see the advantages of virtual working. However, the committee heard other more sceptical views, including fundamental concerns about how this impacts on the solemnity of justice and practical concerns such as digital exclusion. The committee's view was that more virtual trials need to take place in the criminal courts before a properly informed view can be taken about making them permanent. And in particular, we were concerned that only a limited number of virtual summary trials had gone ahead. So in effect, there needs to be an expansion of the pilot so more evidence can be gathered as to their effectiveness. If the Scottish Government was to seek to extend the temporary provisions beyond 2023, the committee would expect to see robust evidence to justify this. And the committee notes in the Scottish Government's response their intention to consult more broadly on virtual proceedings, including improving victims' experiences in the justice system, for example, virtual trials in summary proceedings. A second temporary measure in the bill relates to fiscal fines. The bill temporarily increases the maximum level of fiscal fine available to prosecutors from £300 to £500. And on balance, a majority of the committee supported these temporary provisions. However, the committee is of the view that there should be more transparency and involved reporting on the use of fiscal fines. And importantly, this may help victims understand the process. And we would also question any moves to extend the fiscal fine provisions to include more types of crime. And the committee noted the Scottish Government response highlighting existing reporting on fiscal fines and the reassurance provided around the temporary nature of this measure. The bill proposes a relaxation on a temporary basis of the statutory time limits which criminal proceedings are subject to. Some witnesses describe these provisions as a necessary evil, given the need to ensure the delivery of justice. The committee's view is that the further extension of time limits is concerning. Our view is that there are good reasons for returning to normal time limits as soon as feasible. And the committee seeks reassurance that the use of extended time limits will be monitored and used proportionately. And the committee notes the Scottish Government's response, agreeing that extended time limits should not be the new normal. So finally, there is also a temporary power in the bill to allow Scottish ministers to make regulations to release certain people from prisons and young offenders' institutions early. Various safeguards around the use of these powers are included in the bill. The committee view is that a balance must be struck between the risks associated with early release of prisoners and the risks associated with a COVID outbreak in prison. We consider these powers should be used only in the case of a significant deterioration in the COVID-19 position in Scotland, where an outbreak cannot be managed through any other measure except reducing the prison population. And the Cabinet Secretary has provided reassurance that he has no current plans to use these powers. Any regulation on early release of prisoners would be subject to close parliamentary scrutiny by the committee. So I want to conclude by saying that in the time available to it, the Criminal Justice Committee has given careful consideration to the justice provisions in the bill. And if the bill passes at stage one, we stand ready to consider these justice provisions on a line-by-line basis at stage two. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicol. I now call Arianne Burgess to speak on behalf of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Burgess.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This bill covered many areas of policy, as we've heard, beyond the scope of any single committee, with the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee's clear remit for housing issues and our keen interest in homelessness and ensuring that everyone is able to have somewhere secure that they can call home. We welcome the opportunity to consider Part 4 of the legislation. The bill will continue some, but not all, of the mitigations for tenants introduced during the pandemic. It makes all grounds for evictions discretionary and provides for landlords to undertake certain actions to support tenants when rent arrears start to build. Making the grounds for evictions discretionary ensures that the Tier 1 tribunal can consider all sides and perspectives when eviction is sought. The provision ensures that there is more... Yes.
Michelle Thompson.
I read the Local Government Housing Planning Committee report with interest, but noticed that it didn't include all types of housing providers. This quote from the Scottish Property Federation: "We believe that the overall impact of the provisions could be to weaken the PRS by fuelling a perception of regulation and risk for investors that will undermine efforts to attract capital investment to the sector." So, can I ask that the committee in the future reflects further on the impact of all stakeholders and all housing providers in making an assessment as we go through the stages?
Arianne Burgess.
I thank the member for the comment, and I will take that on board. And if you allow me to continue, you will hear that we are aware of those things. The provision ensures that there is more security for tenants, breathing space for both parties to consider what is the best outcome. It reduces the likelihood of a family potentially becoming homeless. The tribunal will have the opportunity to balance the needs of tenants with the rights and needs of landlords. We heard loud and clear from the organisations supporting and advising tenants that they support these changes in the emergency legislation becoming permanent. The actions of landlords, such as discussing ways in which any debt can be repaid or in signposting tenants to support when a tenant starts falling behind in their rent, will also be considered by the tribunal when eviction is sought. This is what happens in the social housing sector and presents a humane way to respond to a family struggling to remain in their home. Witnesses representing landlords made their case clearly and thoughtfully and allowed us to understand the risks landlords could face and their concerns about the bill creating uncertainty for landlords. We understand that properties might have been purchased to fund retirement or be required for landlords' own housing needs. The tribunal can consider these factors fully in its deliberations. Witnesses representing landlords also highlighted the potential unintended consequences of these perceived risks, that landlords would exit the long-term private rented market, so worsening the situation for those seeking to rent privately. We were made aware that the vast majority of landlords in Scotland have only one rental property and were reliant on it as an investment that they could realise when they needed to. Finally, we heard that the relationship between local authorities with the responsibility for homelessness and the private rental sector needs to improve. Good mutual understanding is required, as it is an understanding of the nature of the sector across local authorities to allow better collaboration to prevent homelessness. While we hear the concerns of landlords, a tribunal will still be able to grant an eviction and use its discretion to decide what is a reasonable and fair outcome for both landlords and tenants. So to conclude, the committee supports that these provisions are made permanent, with the understanding that a comprehensive housing bill will be introduced in the next parliamentary year. We believe that these provisions will provide continuity and security for tenants in the short to medium term. The government must closely monitor the effects, both intended and unintended, of this legislation in front of us now. Will evictions reduce? Will the sector shrink and landlords leave the market, worsening homelessness in the longer term? We hope yes to the first and no to the second. But in any event, we ask that evidence is made available ahead of any future housing legislation. Landlords should be reassured that we will look closely at the effects of this change during our scrutiny of any future legislation in this area. And we also urge the government to work closely with the private rented sector and local authorities. We must recognise the invaluable contribution made by the private sector in offering a healthy mixed economy of long-term housing options. And all levels of government need to work in a constructive way to prevent homelessness. A place that is safe to call home provides the most fundamental base for families to thrive.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. I now call on Stephen Kerr to speak on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Presiding Officer, on this occasion I am delighted to speak on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People's Committee on our work at Stage 1 for the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. Our committee considered the provisions in Part 2 of the Bill, which are designed to ensure that Scottish ministers have powers to enable educational establishments to take action to protect public health and ensure the continuity of educational provision relating to the temporary closure or conditions on the functioning of educational establishments for student accommodation and how local authorities would need to undertake consultations about proposals in relation to schools. The committee is grateful to all those who provided evidence which informed our report. The majority of the committee members were content with the regulation-making powers conferred upon ministers in Part 2 of the Bill. Although the committee was not unanimous in its support, the recommendations that we set out in our report are intended to be constructive and seek to improve the Bill. I don't have a lot of time this afternoon. We've, I think, been only allocated 4 minutes. So I'm going to focus on our recommendations, which call for greater clarity in some of the Part 2 provisions, including those relating to the closure of schools, colleges and universities. In their evidence, both the EIS and COSLA stated that local authorities do not have the power to unilaterally close a school on public health grounds. In such circumstances, a school must obtain permission from the local public health authority. In their evidence, University Scotland and Colleges Scotland stated that the Scottish Government would not have the detailed local knowledge to exercise its powers to make decisions on which departments, buildings or research projects should close in a public health emergency as provided for in the legislation. The Cabinet Secretary acknowledged that such practical issues would require to be managed flexibly and that some exceptions may have to be applied. The committee agreed that local authorities and other stakeholders should have a clear and unambiguous understanding of where responsibility lies to close schools quickly in any future public health emergency. The committee also agreed that it is essential for clarity in how exceptions to closure in university and college settings will be managed. We have therefore called on the Scottish Government to provide further detail on how it intends to consult with institutions to identify those facilities whose closure may not be possible or may have to be limited for practical safety or welfare reasons, and how such issues would be addressed in the development and application of the regulations under this part of the Bill. When the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills gave evidence to the committee, she expressed the Scottish Government's willingness to engage further with key stakeholders to discuss any concerns. The committee welcomed that intent and look forward to hearing more on the results of this engagement at some point this afternoon.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call on Stuart McMillan to speak on behalf of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Playing Officer. First of all, I'm delighted to be speaking in this Stage 1 debate on behalf of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. As has already been touched upon by others, the Bill includes very significant powers which can be exercised using the made affirmative procedure. And given the made affirmative procedure was, until recently, relatively unusual, I want to take a few moments just to highlight the committee's recent inquiry on its use during the pandemic. This work actually helped inform and shape the committee's findings for the coronavirus bill in front of us now. The made affirmative procedure, which allows the Scottish Government to change aspects of the law straight away, was usually only seen by the Parliament once or twice a year. Yet since March 2020, the procedure was used more than 150 times. In scrutinising these changes to the law, the committee understood that it was necessary to use emergency powers to respond to the public health emergency. However, our inquiry raised concerns around how clear and accessible the laws created with these powers actually were, particularly when they came into law prior to being scrutinised here in the Scottish Parliament. So we highlighted in our inquiry report a set of principles that might provide the basis for parliamentary scrutiny where legislation includes such provisions, and that this bill is a prime example of that. Our Stage 1 report, reflecting what we found in our inquiry, recommended that the Scottish Government bring forward amendments for each power which can be exercised subject to the made affirmative procedure. And these statutory requirements would be threefold. Firstly, that each SSI is accompanied by a written statement explaining and providing evidence for why the regulations need to be made urgently. Secondly, that the Government include an assessment of the impact of the instrument on all those likely to be affected. And thirdly, that such SSIs are subject to a sunset provision so that the changes to the law don't continue to be in force indefinitely. From the response to our Stage 1 report and also the comments from the Deputy First Minister earlier, the Scottish Government is intending to bring forward an amendment to provide an explanation of urgency and also considering adding a sunset provision to the powers at Stage 2, and I'm sure that colleagues in the committee will welcome those. Turning briefly to each of the five powers which can be exercised subject to the made affirmative procedure, there wasn't the same consensus among committee members. And these are the five points: the public health protection regulations in Section 1, the continuing operation of educational establishments in Section 8, school boarding accommodation in Section 9, the student accommodation in Section 10, and the early release from prison or a young offenders institution in paragraph 24(1) of the schedule. Now, some members of the committee considered that the Scottish Government did not make a sufficient case for why these powers should be delegated and such changes to the law could instead be brought forward quickly under primary legislation. However, the majority of the committee, that is three of the five members, were content with the delegation of each of the powers in principle. Nevertheless, on school boarding and student accommodation, the committee considered by a majority of 3 to 5 members that each power should only be capable of being exercised subject to the affirmative procedure. I also note that the COVID-19 Recovery Committee's recommendations around the Henry VIII powers, our call for a statement of urgency when making such regulations in an emergency, might provide additional limitations to the potential use of the made affirmative procedure when exercising such Henry VIII powers. Now, very briefly, Presiding Officer, the committee also is working with the Scottish Government to develop a protocol for what we have called an expedited affirmative procedure, and the Deputy First Minister touched upon that earlier on today. Now, this is work that certainly kind of follows on from previous protocols that have been established between the Delegated Powers Law Reform Committee and also the Scottish Government in the past. I certainly believe that this particular protocol could be used in place of the made affirmative procedure. So, in closing, I would state the committee's consistent and strongly held position that the Scottish Government should use the affirmative procedure in all but exceptional and urgent circumstances. And I note that what the Cabinet Secretary said earlier in the debate, and the committee does look forward to seeing the fruits of that when we next consider the bill following amendments at Stage 2. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McMillan. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak on behalf of Scottish Conservatives. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by reminding members of my register of interests, in that I am a member of the Law Society of Scotland and I derive some income from rental properties. I am also a member of the Church of Scotland, to which I will mention later. And can I start by joining with the convener of the COVID Recovery Committee and indeed other committee conveners in thanking all those who gave our committee and the other committees evidence at Stage 1, and thank our committee clerks for their support. And the COVID Recovery Committee produced a very detailed and thorough report on this bill, which I would commend to all members. The Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill seeks to make permanent emergency powers which were taken to the Scottish Government in order to deal with the coronavirus pandemic. Some of what is in this bill is very sensible in terms of providing long-term reform. For example, we would have no hesitation in supporting measures to allow nurses to administer vaccinations on an ongoing basis. And we would agree with some of the proposals to move to digital and online services that currently have to be provided face-to-face. But too much of this bill is simply not necessary at this stage. To make permanent what were emergency and extraordinary powers passes control from Parliament to the Government. It represents a power grab on the part of SNP ministers, and that is not something that we can support. And the depth of concern about what was proposed was illustrated by the consultation run by the COVID Recovery Committee, which the convener referred to earlier. Nearly 4,000 respondents completed the committee's survey. I cannot remember a response as large as that, with as many as 90% expressing concern at what is being proposed. And there were also many stakeholders who detailed their opposition to the powers in this bill. Yes, I will.
John Mason.
I know what the member says, but would he accept now that the quite major concessions made by the Deputy First Minister do allay these concerns?
Murdo Fraser.
Well, I think that remains to be seen, I have to say to the member. I recognise that some concessions have been made, but nevertheless, this bill will still be on the statute book. It still represents a shift of power away from Parliament to government. And the trigger mechanism proposed by the Cabinet Secretary would still not give Parliament the opportunity to amend this legislation if it came before Parliament as and when required. So we will still have reservations about it, and we will see what stakeholders have to say about this in due course. And when it came to the general principles, the committee only agreed to support the bill on the casting vote of the convener. There is no consensus that this bill is required, and that is why we will be opposing it at decision time this evening. Now, the Scottish Government argues that the measures in this bill simply reflects the legislation elsewhere in the United Kingdom. But the fact is that this bill's provisions go well beyond what is permitted elsewhere. There are in this bill no time limits on the amount of time that can be removed of a prisoner's release, unlike the situation south of the border. One of the most controversial aspects of this bill, the use of Henry VIII powers, is not reflected in the equivalent legislation south of the border.
Deputy First Minister.
I'm grateful to Mr Fraser for giving way. Doesn't Mr Fraser accept the argument that I've put forward and put forward to committee that there are deficiencies in the legislation that Scotland has on the statute book? And the way to solve that is to legislate, to put us in a position to address some of the issues in the England and Wales position, which enables the authorities in England and Wales to better prepare for pandemics in the future. Surely that's an important issue that we need to consider with open minds in this legislative process.
Murdo Fraser.
But you see, there was an alternative approach that the government could have pursued. It was an alternative approach proposed to the committee by Professor Fiona de Londres of Birmingham University, whereby Parliament could agree draft legislation which would deal with the issues in this bill, draft legislation that could be left on the shelf to be introduced as and when required. Because this Parliament demonstrated 2 years ago it can legislate very quickly in an emergency situation. We've already proved that it can be done, and that is the way we could have approached this bill. And crucially, that would put Parliament in control of the process and not the government, and allow legislation to be amended. So let me turn, if I can, to some of these specific measures. No, I've given way several times. I need to make some progress. Sorry, Mr Fairley. Turning now to some of the specific measures in the bill, my colleague Jamie Green will comment in more detail on the justice provisions. I want to mention the measures on housing and tenancies, where we've had a great deal of concern expressed by stakeholders that temporary measures brought in response to the pandemic are now to be made permanent, restricting the right of landlords to recover possession at the end of a tenancy period. The National Farmers Union of Scotland, Scottish Land and Estates and the Scottish Association of Landlords have combined in a joint submission to state that these proposals will deeply damage the private rental sector and lead to a situation where many landlords could simply withdraw from the sector, thus restricting the supply of property for rent. At a time when rents are already rising, briefly.
Very much. And first, can I put on the record that I have an interest in buy-to-let property, but not institutional investors, as per my earlier point. I would simply note that, is he aware of the National Landlords Association survey of November 2021 that showed 28% of landlords in England and Wales seeking to exit as a direct consequence of Section 24, an unfair tax change introduced by the Westminster Government, and that is having a significant effect.
Martin Fraser.
I recognise there are a number of issues for a private landlord. Of course, the answer to that is not to bring in even more legislation that's going to impact on them, as this bill seeks to do. And the language used in the joint submission by NFUS, Scottish Land and Estates and the Scottish Association of Landlords is striking, saying that the government's suggestion that stopping the emergency provisions would cause confusion is, in their words, at best spurious and at worst deliberately dishonest. So the Scottish Government really need to listen to these sectors. And it's not just those representing landlords who have raised these concerns. We also heard from churches, including the Church of Scotland, whose concern is they will no longer be able to safely let out church properties such as manses, which might be temporarily vacant, without the security of knowing they can recover possession for when they are needed for a new minister. So the consequence of this is likely to be that these properties will simply lie empty rather than be made available for housing. and that must be contrary to public policy, and yet it's an unintended consequence of what the government are proposing. I'm very happy to take a further intervention if I have time.
Ms. Pease, I appreciate your generosity in that regard, but actually you should be bringing
should
your
be
remarks to a close.
Right. Okay. So my apologies, Mr. Harvey. Elsewhere in the bill, there are concerns over the powers to close educational establishments. Mr. Kerr referred to these concerns over the impact on universities and colleges. The Education Secretary went to the Education Committee to say that the power to shut down universities was necessary in the case of defiance by right-wing university principals. Yeah. Now, if there are right-wing university principals in Scotland, Deputy Presiding Officer, I really would like to meet them, but I fear that is a bogus argument. And, Presiding Officer, there are very serious concerns I don't have time to cover about the Henry VIII powers which are in the bill before us. So, Presiding Officer, we cannot accept this transfer of power from Parliament to government. It is unjustified and inappropriate, and for these reasons we will be opposing the bill at stage one. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. I now call on Jackie Bailey to open on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms. Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in the stage one debate on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill. It could have been an opportunity to pass legislation that supports Scotland's recovery and introduces some sensible and much needed change. But this bill is unfortunately more about legacy legislation than looking forward. It does react to past challenges whilst failing to learn lessons from the pandemic. And the Scottish Government is wanting to drive through legislation before the independent public inquiry has had a chance to examine the Government's handling of the pandemic. The SNP are pushing through a bill that, as it stands, would have serious and long-term consequences for this country and for our democracy. And I think it's fair to say that throughout their 15 years in office, the SNP have been very effective in centralising power to St Andrew's House. This bill is another step on that trajectory. This would grant ministers far-reaching powers to bring forward, amend or repeal laws without advance parliamentary scrutiny, and therefore the bill as it stands must, in our view, be opposed. I will, however, examine the detail of the Deputy First Minister's proposal about his amendment, and we will come back to that. But we know, of course.
Deputy First Minister.
I'm grateful to Jackie Bailey for giving way, but you know, I've explained with care to Parliament that the Government is substantively amending in response to exactly the feedback that Jackie Bailey has put to me. Yeah. The necessity of ensuring greater parliamentary oversight and prior decision-making. Now, I hope that makes a substantial difference to the thinking of the Labour Party in approaching, with an open mind, the legislation that's now before Parliament.
Jackie Bailey.
And let me repeat the point that I made before the Deputy First Minister stood up, is that we will examine the detail of his proposal before it comes to stage two. But, you know, we know that as well as the SNP being a centralising government that sucks power up, is also a government that is completely lacking in transparency and takes pride in a culture of secrecy at its very heart. Well, you know, I can only call what I see and what the people of Scotland see each and every day. Now, had this bill, Presiding Officer, been in place at the start of the pandemic, the SNP would have succeeded in their attempt to suspend freedom of information law, an important tool to hold any government to account, which the SNP resist at every turn, would have been suspended for an indefinite period. That would undoubtedly have harmed our democracy. These so-called Henry VIII powers amount to a power grab and must be opposed in their entirety. And I think we can all acknowledge that the Scottish Government's response to the pandemic was flawed in part. When it came to PPE, the withdrawal of many social care services, the transfer of patients from hospital untested, and other measures besides, the Government didn't always get it right. This bill would have the effect of enabling the Scottish Government to double down on those errors with no checks and balances in place to stop them. Ministers would have the ability to do all sorts of things, such as the closing of schools without approval from local government or parliament. These proposals don't just lack transparency, they're simply not necessary. The parliament has shown time and time again that it can respond quickly to events as they unfold, allowing MSPs from all constituencies and across all parties to scrutinise, debate and perfect legislation in a robust way. In fact, the Parliament's first ever piece of legislation was passed in just a week. The Mental Health Public Safety and Appeal Scotland Bill is proof of how quickly Parliament can act and is evidence that making temporary powers permanent is unnecessary. When Holyrood was formed 23 years ago, key principles were adopted to ensure that the Parliament would serve the people of Scotland well. These principles stated that the Scottish Parliament should embody and reflect the sharing of power between the people of Scotland, the legislators and the Scottish Executive. The Scottish Executive should be accountable to the Scottish Parliament, and the Parliament and Executive should in turn be accountable to the people of Scotland. The bill before us flies in the face of the very principles on which this Parliament was built. To support this bill in its current form is therefore inappropriate, and the SNP and Greens should not use their majority in this Parliament to ram this through. Let me turn to other aspects of the bill. There are many individual provisions that Scottish Labour view as positive. The proposals around vaccination, for example, ensuring that a wider group of healthcare staff are able to administer vaccines over the course of the pandemic, ease the pressure on GP services, allowing them to focus on primary care. The continuation of this policy makes sense going forward. The bill would also allow parents to register the birth of their children online rather than in person, a move that is befitting of the 21st century. Further sections of the bill tackle homelessness, bankruptcy provisions. These are a step in the right direction. It is a shame, then, that these proposals come wrapped together with handing sweeping powers to ministers. The point has also been made that there are other, perhaps better, legislative opportunities to take these measures forward. Other proposals have caused concern on justice. The bill states that it would extend the period in which proceedings must commence to 9 months. The committee believes that the proposed extension is too long. The Law Society have even argued that this should be done on a case-by-case basis. So, Presiding Officer, I am afraid that Scottish Labour will not be supporting the general principles of the bill at stage one, because it is largely a power grab and undermines the role of the Parliament in scrutinising and shaping legislation. But it doesn't just deny the Parliament that opportunity, it denies the people of Scotland that opportunity. If the Scottish Government want our support for this bill, they must take the contentious powers off the table by stage two.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton to open on behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I rise for the Scottish Liberal Democrats to speak to stage one of this legislation. When we were forced to lock down in March 2020, Scottish Liberal Democrats reluctantly agreed to the deep and wide-ranging powers granted to the Scottish Government that were necessary to get us through the worst of the pandemic. We turned those bills around in just days, but they were not meant to last forever. There have undoubtedly been lessons learned from the pandemic, and it is right that sensible reforms are made in response to that. The situation forced public services to innovate, and many found new ways of working and adaptations which should, by rights, be retained. Much of this bill falls into that category, particularly those items which will allow the sensible use of technology when appropriate, providing the necessary infrastructure is in place and the changes are given scrutiny. However, my party and I are clear that many aspects of this bill represent an unprecedented power grab by the Scottish Government. And despite the concessions announced this afternoon by the Deputy First Minister, still represent an unacceptable transfer of power between the legislature and the executive. The Parliament would never have countenance handing over many of these powers to ministers before the pandemic, and we must not do so now. This bill would represent a permanent transfer of some powers from the Parliament to the Executive, undermining democracy and civil liberties in the process. That is chilling. It is made even more troubling by the fact that it is wholly unnecessary and perhaps even unhelpful. On the 24th of March 2020, just as millions of people were put into lockdown, Nicola Sturgeon said, and I quote her, "I am very clear that the emergency powers are necessary, but that they should be used only if and when we deem it necessary, and they should exist only for as long as they are needed." She then went on to say, "At a time when we are taking emergency powers and asking the public to do things that restrict the liberty of all of us, scrutiny is absolutely essential." So what has changed? Well, it seems that government has simply grown quite accustomed to having some of these unprecedented powers. They no longer feel the same sense of uneasiness or solemnity. I will give way.
Jim Fairley.
Just like to ask, thank you very much for giving way. I'd just like to ask, do you not agree that the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government,
should have the same level of legislative authority to be able to make these decisions as is held in England and Wales.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Well, firstly, I would contend that this is not a mirror image of the legislation south of the border, and Liberal Democrats south of the border oppose that legislation as well. Let's be honest, this is a government that centralises power at its leisure. It has taken every opportunity to transfer control from local authorities to St Andrew's House. There can be absolutely no justification for the executive to permanently retain the ability to shut schools, release prisoners, impose lockdowns, and the thought is still quite alarming. Presiding officer, we couldn't have legislated for everything that we needed to respond to COVID-19 before we'd heard of it, nor any more than we can now legislate for the next variant of COVID-19 or perhaps the next pandemic that may come down the track. Far better, as others have said, particularly Murdo Fraser, to instruct civil servants now to prepare draft legislation, a toolkit, if you like, to put on the shelf and to be ready for that eventuality. The power to make changes to our justice or educational systems, for example, should come from the ground up. They should lie with those who understand those systems, have an existing responsibility to manage them, and are able to monitor the impact of any changes made. And if this bill was used in future without scrutiny and unanimous backing of this Parliament, then the public support for the necessary measures would be immediately undermined. Even with the concessions announced today, this Parliament would not be able to amend such strictures. If you don't take my word for it, then perhaps listen to Michael Russell, who during the Stage 3 debate on the Coronavirus Scotland Bill said it was important for the Scottish people to see the unanimous support of their Parliament for the action being taken. That cannot be guaranteed with what is proposed. It was as important then as it is now and ever shall be in the future. Presiding officer, this bill has been badly thought out and the government's argument for it is paper thin. The Deputy First Minister has said that it will allow the government to speed up the sufficient comprehensive action in the event of a future pandemic or public health emergency. But in March 2020, faced with an unprecedented situation and without access to many of the facts, this Parliament was able to pass the necessary legislation in a matter of days. And there isn't even a guarantee that the measures in this bill would even be helpful in the face of a future different virus. Far more appropriate, as I have said, would be to draft primary legislation ready to go at a moment's notice. That way, Parliament would only need to decide which and whatever powers in the legislation that was drafted were necessary and proportionate without the need to write them from scratch. That's not just my view. The Justice Committee has also raised that as an alternative. To be clear, I am all for the government having a better plan for future pandemics. Their silver swan strategy planned for the wrong type of pandemic. It overlooked care homes. It didn't even mention testing. We do not need something better. But this bill is not it. Let's not forget that during the recent pandemic, the government needed the scrutiny of Parliament to prevent them taking the gratuitous step of stopping jury trials for the first time in 800 years. The scrutiny of this Parliament really, really matters. Presiding officer, Nicola Sturgeon has said many times that she didn't want these powers for a moment longer than necessary, and yet here we are. The SNP talk a good game about the importance of democracy when it suits them. But this bill demonstrates that they do not possess the necessary wisdom and humility to safeguard it. The Liberal Democrats see it as one of our core duties to stand up for civil liberties and democracy. The clue is in our name. Therefore, we wholeheartedly reject this paragraph and the cynical, quite frankly, chilling politics that it represents. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. We will now move to the open debate, and the speeches are 5 minutes. There is no time in hand, and therefore any interventions must be absorbed within the allocated time. I call John Mason to be followed by Megan Gallagher. Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. There's a lot in this bill that is welcomed by all members of the COVID Committee, not least the increase in the amount owed before a creditor can force a debtor into bankruptcy, the remote registration of births and deaths, and vaccinations not having to be under the control of a medical practitioner. So actually, much of this bill is not contentious at all. Where there has been a bit of disagreement has concerned what legislation should be put in place now so that a future government would be better placed to act quickly in comparison to the rushed primary legislation we needed in early 2020. It is true that we did rush legislation through at that point, and on the whole, it has worked. However, again, most of us would agree it was not perfect and could have been better if it had not been so rushed. Of course, the next problem is that we do not know what the next pandemic or other crisis might be. That could be an argument for doing nothing just now and waiting to see what happens. But it would seem unfortunate if we're not at least a bit better prepared next time compared to this time. There certainly would be a problem... Let me finish this line. There certainly would be a problem next time round if, say, half the MSPs caught the virus right at the start and Parliament itself was more disrupted than it was last time round. Mr Whittle.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful to Mr Mason for giving way. Would he, given that he's suggested that we don't know the nature of what's coming down the line, wouldn't it be better to have the legislation waiting at the side to be enacted, yeah, so that we can amend that legislation to recognise the pandemic or whatever emergency comes down the line?
John Mason.
I mean, I do accept that as one option, but I still think that having the legislation in place ready, and I think the Cabinet Deputy First Minister has given a reassurance that that legislation will not come into effect until Parliament agrees, and obviously there will be a need for further legislation at that time which Parliament can be involved in. So no, I do not accept that point. So I do wonder if there's, but I do wonder if there's not room for compromise in all this, and that's what we're hearing this afternoon from the Government. That is very positive. Now, we took a fair amount of evidence on the question of what is a proportionate response and whether a threat is serious or imminent. Some witnesses in the committee tended to feel that we did need a bit more explanation on this. The policy memorandum does outline the kinds of factors which might be considered, but the bill itself does not. At paragraph 42, the committee was inclined to seek some of this detail appearing on the face of the bill itself. Now, I note that the Government is not convinced about this, and I do accept that there are risks with being overly prescriptive. The Government's response refers to providing definitions, although I do not think the committee was going quite as far as that in actually asking for definitions, more a non-exhaustive list of factors to be considered. Again, I think there might be room for a bit of compromise on this. Concerning the made affirmative procedure, I know that the DPLR committee had serious concerns about the frequency with which this procedure was being used. And we previously had a debate on this subject. I agree that there is a need for parliamentary oversight on this, and so I do welcome the Government's agreement to bring forward amendments at stage two, specifically to require an explanation of urgency when the MAP is used. Moving on to the Henry VIII powers and committee's recommendation at paragraph 57, the committee invited the Government to consider this point. Therefore, I do welcome the fact that the Government is proposing amendments. We are seeking to get a balance here between the Government having the necessary powers to act in an emergency and Parliament having a role and duty to hold Government to account. I think we have to remember here too that although we currently have a nice Government headed by Nicola Sturgeon and John Swinney, there is always the remote chance of a nasty Government headed up by Douglas Ross or someone like him in the future. So we do not want that type of Government to have unlimited powers. As I said at the beginning, there was a general welcome for the option of registering births and deaths online and for some licensing meetings to take place remotely or in a hybrid format. However, this comes with the proviso that some people are unable to take part in a digital way, and also that some situations are better handled in person. For example, sensitive discussions with a vulnerable person about what exactly should go on the birth certificate might be best done in person. Therefore, there was some concern at committee that there might be a conscious or unconscious drift towards more and more services being provided digitally and fewer being available in person. Local authorities are obviously also aware of the need for balance in this, but it was felt the Government should at least consider if stronger protection for in-person services should be made in the bill. I'm obviously running out of time, but I would say I'm happy to support this bill at stage one. The committee has made clear it would like to see some amendments, and so I look forward to that at stage two. But this bill will help us be better prepared for the next pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. I now call Megan Gallagher to be followed by CoCab Stewart. Up to 5 minutes, please, Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In 2020, the UK Government passed the Coronavirus Act that gave Scottish ministers the ability to create regulations to protect members of the public against the spread of coronavirus in Scotland. At the time, the Act was necessary as it allowed governments to have the freedom to make decisions out with normal processes during the peak of the pandemic. Fast forward 2 years, and I'm relieved that governments are now focusing their attention on economic recovery across the United Kingdom. It was reassuring to see figures released today that show the UK economy for the first quarter of 2022 had faster growth than the USA, France, Germany, Italy, Spain and the EU. This outlines the UK Government's commitment to get our country back on track. However, it is concerning that following the Scottish Government's introduction of the Coronavirus Scotland Act 2020, the SNP intends to make these powers permanent. And although the Deputy First Minister announced measures regarding safeguards, the unpopular coronavirus bill would allow the SNP to impose lockdowns, release prisoners early and close schools without the appropriate parliamentary scrutiny or vote. At this stage, MSPs, even though we've heard the announcement today, still do not know the wording of the amendment that this government seeks to make. Therefore, the bill will need to be taken at face value when voting this evening. And given that we do not know at this stage or if or when the next pandemic will emerge here in Scotland, a point that Alex Cole-Hamilton made earlier, it is my view that we should not be passing a blanket law, especially before a public inquiry has been completed. My colleague Murdo Fraser highlighted within his contribution that there are some aspects of the bill that provide much-needed longer-term reforms, such as measures that would allow nurses to administer vaccinations and the ability to move digital and online services. I agree that these are sensible proposals. However, there are still concerns following the announcement today that will require further consideration by MSPs in this Parliament. As Murdo Fraser stated, although safeguards have been announced, there are serious questions yet to be addressed, such as future amendments on this piece of legislation. From an education perspective, there are flaws with this bill and it could have a detrimental impact on our schools and educational facilities. During the peak of the pandemic, the Scottish Government had the power to close schools in response to outbreaks of the virus. This, of course, was to keep pupils and teachers safe. However, Part 2 of the Coronavirus Bill, as it stands, will allow Scottish ministers to shut down schools and change term and exam dates without a vote taking place in this chamber. The EIS said that the Scottish Government could use emergency powers to close schools for other purposes, and that is a cause of concern. This, of course, could upset the balance of power between local authorities and the Scottish Government. We know that the SNP are obsessed with power, and that would be a step too far, even for them. When it comes to education, ministers do not need additional powers that will hinder our young people's ability to learn in the classroom. They need to utilise the powers they already have to increase teacher numbers, reduce the attainment gap and to improve school standards. Presiding officer, overreach of Scottish ministers speak to a lack of trust in our university and college sector, as well as local government. The NASUWT has also expressed serious concerns about making permanent some of the powers within the 2020 Act. The union raised concerns over the government's contempt for scrutiny and the ability for opposition MSPs to carry out their role by holding this government to account. Colleges have also stated that the bill's provisions are not necessary. In their written submission to the Education, Children and Young People Committee, they stated, "On the basis of this experience, we would advise that the intended provisions which have been proposed within the bill are not required." The Scottish Government could use other methods out with the bill to implement measures in the event of another crisis. And I believe that on this point, further consideration should be made by the Scottish Government as preparation for an emergency could take place without the need to legislate. With many educational institutions speaking out against the bill, the Scottish Government must listen to their concerns. Instead of using bizarre explanations such as needing the power to shut down universities in case of right-wing defiance to justify their previous intentions. Presiding officer, the Scottish Conservatives believe that the COVID bill should be scrapped. Ministers should be trying to empower our educational settings instead of trying to remove decision-making from them as part of an SNP power grab. To conclude, presiding officer, the Scottish Conservatives have been clear in our position on COVID recovery and we have already seen some of our asks implemented. There are still other measures that we would like to see introduced, such as a national tutoring programme and a school catch-up premium, to ensure our young people are front and centre of this government's priorities when it comes to COVID recovery. I agree with the educational institutions that have spoken out against the bill. I will be voting to ensure that government ministers do not implement bills which are, in its entirety, not necessary and could create more problems than it resolves. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. I now call Cocab Stewart to be followed by Michael Mara. Up to 5 minutes, please, Ms Stewart.
Thank you, presiding officer. I would refer to my register of interests as a union member. I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate on this important piece of legislation whose, I believe, sole purpose is to empower government to act swiftly in the interests of public health in order to prevent illness and death and to protect public services in the event of future outbreaks of this deadly virus. I further welcome the Deputy First Minister's clarification that Parliament will always be required to approve the use of the powers included in the bill. There are also clearly defined caveats included in the bill, that, and I'll refer to those later. The impact of the current pandemic is fresh in our collective memory at this moment in time. The effect on daily lives of the first and subsequent lockdowns will be felt in so many ways for years to come. And we are enjoying some uplift of that and getting some kind of normality back. But staff in schools and other educational institutions faced a hugely challenging situation, both in terms of how they delivered education to their pupils and students and in terms of their duty of care. As someone who worked in education throughout the first lockdown in March 2020, it was a complete shock to everyone involved when schools were closed overnight and we literally had to turn on a sixpence to adopt remote learning practices with little or no experience in my case. And nevertheless, we know that our schools and teachers were a real lifeline for children and families at that time. By the second lockdown at the end of 2020, with action from the Scottish Government on speeding up local delivery of technology and funding of Connective, provided by Connecting Scotland to deliver tablets and Wi-Fi devices via various partners and schools, pupils were much better prepared to teach and learn remotely, and improvements are continuing to be made there. The provisions of this bill underline that commitment of continuity to learning, and there are repeated caveats throughout included in the sections dealing with the powers to make provisions relating to continuing operation of an educational establishment for a specific period. The bill confirms that this power is only to be used if this is necessary and proportionate action, or in connection with protection of public health. What this ultimately means is that remote learning, nobody's preferred option, not teachers, parents or children, can be introduced quickly across the country, and if and only if it is deemed necessary and proportionate in the interests of public health. Having worked as a teacher before, during and after lockdowns, I am fully aware of the challenges faced and understand the concerns of the teaching unions. I thank the NASUWT for their briefing sent to all members outlining their concerns, some of which will have been addressed by the Deputy First Minister's updates on his amendments today. The reason for this bill is clear: the ability to act swiftly, comprehensively, to save lives and protect services is absolutely vital. The commitment from the Deputy First Minister that the Scottish Parliament will always be consulted before the legislation is enacted is welcome and reassures me that the sole purpose of this legislation is to serve the public good in the event of a future and deadly strain of this virus. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Stewart. I now call Michael Mara to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I suppose in these days of spring in Scotland, things are beginning to feel a little bit more normal. We seem to be a society going about our business again. But behind the doors, we are a country that is significantly broken, and the collapse of services and economic impacts and the grief that remains, and our recovery is not really yet beginning. But by most metrics, the record of the whole of the UK in response to COVID-19 has been truly dreadful. It is among the worst in the world for deaths, for infections and for the economic impact that we're only beginning to feel fully. The full inquiry into the pandemic will unpick many of these issues. It should help us to learn the lessons, but nobody has been able to explain to me, the parliamentary committee on which I sit, or the chamber today or previous to this moment, why this legislation is required ahead of the conclusions of that inquiry. And this is not a question of parliamentary procedure or of putting process before people, certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Michael Mara for giving way, and I'll of course elaborate on these points in the closing. But neither he or I have the gift of knowing how long that public inquiry will take, and therefore having the powers to prepare for the next pandemic is surely crucial. Those powers mirrored in English and Welsh legislation.
Michael Mara.
Thank you. And I think that happy... Thank you. I think it's fair to say that there's a couple of points in response to that. We have legislation on the books at the moment that has been passed that lasts until September, and we have been able as a parliament to extend that legislation quite easily and at short notice, and that option still remains for us. I would say to the Cabinet Secretary that he doesn't know what the next pandemic is going to be. He doesn't know what the preparations that are going to be required. And it's not certain, far from certain, in fact, that it is in this Act, I would say. One of the principal reasons for our country's dreadful record in handling the pandemic is that we were acting to the wrong plan. A plan for a flu pandemic instead of the pandemic we actually faced. Yep. And the mistakes made from the outset have become ossified in public policy. And we still appear, at times, I would say, to treat this as a disease spread in droplets rather than the airborne pathogen that we know and has been proven to be. That fatally undermines even our current consideration of preventative measures today, such as ventilation, far too routinely dismissed by this government in spite of available and growing global evidence. A large study carried out in Italy showed that 6 air changes in an hour in a classroom will reduce infections by 82%. The findings of a recent major study from the University of Leeds show that HEPA filters is an effective backup where high-performing mechanical ventilation is unavailable. There's a wealth of growing evidence, yet this government, the Scottish Government, has refused requests for rollouts, have no commissioned scientific trials of their own, and seem to be locked in a mode of thinking from outdated guidance and plans. Droplets, not airborne, surfaces, not ventilation. All of this is an illustration of a tendency common in all governments, and which we as an opposition and as a parliament must work strongly against. A tendency to fight the last war rather than the war that you're in. A tendency to fight the last pandemic rather than the one that you actually face. Now, it's been bad enough that we as a country failed to prepare, failed to respond timidly to emerging evidence and lost many thousands of our fellow citizens as a result. Now we're being asked to set the response to the last pandemic in the laws of the country when we do not know the shape of what comes next. And nobody has given a reasonable explanation. What I'm attempting to illustrate here is that this is not a step without risk. The next government will reach for what is at hand, and it's our responsibility to make sure the mistakes of this government are not repeated. The evidence presented to the Education, Children and Young People's Committee was overwhelmingly the view that the laws proposed are replete with risk. We were invited by the government to ignore 90-odd% of the respondents, but the evidence that followed was no less supportive of the government's position. Our universities want to know why a government minister is better able to understand the consequences of closing a lab than a university professor. Our colleges want to know why a government minister better understands the physical proximities and practical restraints on training than a lecturer or a technician. These decisions, the consequences of them as well as the making of them, are better done in discussion. The Cabinet Secretary said as much in her evidence and was keen to emphasise how well such discussions had gone this time around. Seemingly, this is a reason not to have them again, when we might face a different pathogen with different behaviours. The committee, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, also listened to significant concerns that this legislation may not be compatible with the European Convention on Human Rights. Very constructive proposals on other possible models of legislative framework bills, which have been discussed already, draft bills waiting for parliamentary approval should they prove to be appropriate. All of this has, to date, been summarily dismissed by ministers. And these suggestions do not come from libertarian, anti-vaxxer conspiracy theorists determined to thwart the work of government. They come from the public payroll organisations who have been partners in this pandemic, and they deserve to be listened to.
Thank you, Mr Marrott. I now call Gillian Mackay to be followed by Jim Fairley. Up to 5 minutes, please, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Before I begin, could I apologise to the Chamber that I will be absent from closing speeches. I'm stepping in to give this speech on behalf of another member who's unwell this afternoon, and I have another engagement during closing speeches. I will return as quickly as possible and would like to thank the Presiding Officer for her tolerance. The process of passing two pieces of emergency legislation at the height of the first phase of the pandemic and before remote participation arrangements had been made was a difficult one for this Parliament. But it was one which I believe showed us in our best light, responding to a crisis generally collegiately and with common purpose. Those bills didn't get everything right, though, and that's one of the key questions we're presented with today. Do we want to leave ourselves in a position of needing to go through that process again? Do we want to delay potentially life-saving actions and self-evidently obvious ones, even for a matter of days, if we are once again hit by a pandemic unlike anything previously seen in living memory? Or do we consolidate what we've learned from this experience so that the necessary powers are available in the event that they are needed? I welcome the Deputy First Minister's commitment to introduce a gateway clause, something the Greens were keen to see introduced to address the perfectly valid concerns about the primacy of Parliament over government. Last session, the Greens amended the Brexit Continuity Bill, and those amendments were designed to provide appropriate limits and safeguards on the Henry VIII powers afforded to the government through that process. So I'm glad to see similar restraint being shown here without it unduly interfering with the government's ability to fulfil its obligations to the public during a future health crisis. Beyond the powers specific to the circumstances of a public health emergency, though, we can all recognise that some of the changes introduced through the two coronavirus acts simply made sense and probably should have been the case all along. The most obvious example of this would be where processes previously only able to be completed in person via hard copy papers can now be done digitally. If we're committed to the delivery of efficient, effective and easy to access public services, returning to the pre-pandemic situation in this area would clearly be a retrograde step. These provisions will be of particular benefit to those in more rural communities for whom the reality of travelling to a council office to register a relative's death, for example, is quite different to that of urban residents. Though it's important to highlight that this isn't an either-or situation. The Association of Registrars were right to point out that for some people, the opportunity to complete such a process in person is important, whether for personal reasons, lack of digital access or some other circumstance. This is not permission for councils to move some services entirely online. One area in which Green MSPs put considerable effort during the two emergency bill processes was housing, specifically the protection of tenants, including those in purpose-built student accommodation. Since then, we've joined the government on the basis of an agreement which includes our New Deal for Tenants proposals now being taken forward by Patrick Harvey as Minister for Tenants' Rights. As far as we are concerned, it was far too easy for landlords to evict tenants before the pandemic, and it's frankly still too easy now. But the protections brought back in 2020 made a real difference to many people who were at risk of losing their homes. And there's simply no good reason for going back to where we were before, a system where all the cards were stacked in favour of landlords. A number of other progressive provisions, first introduced in the context of the emergency, are now appropriately being extended, such as the bankruptcy protections, which, if I remember correctly, were first pushed for by Jackie Bailey. The duty on purpose-built student accommodation providers to take account of the Chief Medical Officer's advice will hopefully avoid a repeat of the scenes we saw at Murano Street Student Village in Glasgow and elsewhere in the autumn of 2020. And there are other provisions I'm glad to see included, but which I don't have time to cover now. Presiding Officer, this bill takes a pragmatic approach to maintaining the improvements which were brought about as a result of our response to the pandemic. It gives government the powers it would need in the event of another such crisis, and with the amendments confirmed today, it will strike the appropriate balance between parliamentary oversight and executive action. And for those reasons, the Greens will be supporting this bill.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Jim Fairley to be followed by Miles Briggs. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, we have all seen them. In fact, the bad boys in my school used to get themselves expelled by abusing them, and ministers now and in the present should take note of that. They are little glass-fronted housing cages with a hammer hanging on the chain with the message, "Break glass in case of emergency." Perhaps if the government had included that fire alarm type warning on the face of the bill, it might have tempered some of the more ludicrous and overhyped descriptions of what this bill actually is. As my colleague John Mason pointed out, there is lots in this bill which we broadly agreed on across the committee, and one area I was particularly keen to stress with the government was digital exclusion and the ability of service users to be able to continue to have face-to-face meetings if they chose to do so, and I'm glad that that issue has been heard. Continuing the theme of agreement, there is one thing we can surely all agree on, and that's that we were not fully prepared for a pandemic before COVID hit us. The various desktop exercises and plans that existed turned out not to be entirely adequate for the reality, and it really would be a pretty catastrophic mistake to make to just go back to where we were. And I don't often quote Winston Churchill, but those that fail to learn from history are doomed to repeat it. So let's not forget that when COVID struck, there was no possibility for us to break the glass in case of emergency, because we didn't have the powers to do so. Had the Scottish Government not extended those powers and put them in our statute book, when they fell in England and Wales, they would have fallen up here as well, as the Coronavirus 2020 Act was in effect parent legislation allowing the Scottish Government to continue to protect the Scottish people with Scottish-centric thinking. My colleague in the committee, Alec Riley, did raise his genuine principal concerns over the Henry VIII powers. And for those concerns, there is generally sympathy right across the committee. And thankfully, during our evidence session with the Deputy First Minister, it's clear that he has taken those concerns on board and delivered what I believe to be an eminently sensible solution, a trigger clause that means those powers are only exercisable in the event of a genuine emergency, as dictated by professionals who are charged with delivering the kind of support we saw during the pandemic. Now, during the committee, I put it to Professor Londres that the bill simply means that in legislative sense we are preparing ourselves for the future so that in the event of another emergency we have the legislative competence to enable us to deal with it in this Parliament. I asked her if that was a fair assessment and she said, yes, that is exactly right. So only after an emergency has been declared and the Parliament had time to debate it can the government lift that wee hammer and smash the glass to release those powers. Indeed, it was the Tory member Sandish Gulhani, during portfolio questions raised by Jackie Bailey on the 23rd of March, who asked for that provision. Who asked for that provision in the first place in this chamber? And not only has it been delivered, the government have gone further. So I hope that Alec Rowley has been satisfied with that agreement. Who was asking for an intervention?
Alec Gulhani.
I'm very grateful to Jim Farley giving way. He has talked about the time that would be taken by the Parliament to debate and to allow this smashing of the glass with this hammer for this emergency legislation. Does he not recognise that this Parliament has shown itself eminently capable of turning around primary legislation in a matter of hours to respond to imminent threats? Does he not see that we could do that again?
Jim Farley.
Absolutely accept that there is the possibility of that to happen if the Parliament can sit in permanent. But you've no idea what the next pandemic or what the next emergency is going to be. Therefore, it is required to have legislation sitting ready to go. Now, the real irony of this debate is, as has already been mentioned, that this bill just brings us into line with England and Wales, who already have these powers. So one has to wonder why the Tories are so desperate to hamstring this Parliament's ability to act quickly and effectively with these powers ready to use at a moment's notice. Now, I'll concede that the Henry VIII's powers are controversial. I am satisfied with Mr Swinney's announcement today. I would, however, make one final point, Presiding Officer. The opposition members are absolutely right to point out that these powers do go further than England and Wales powers in respect of what powers are available under health protection. Although they are comparable to Schedule 19 of the UK Coronavirus Act 2020 and Section 45(f)(2) of the Public Health Control Diseases Act 1994, neither of these two UK acts contain Henry VIII powers. But the UK government does have and has used the Civil Contingency Act of 2004, which in effect gives it the right to impose Henry VIII powers over anything it likes if it declares it an emergency. Therefore, the Tory objections to this part of the bill seems to be it's OK for Westminster to hold such powers for all scenarios, but the Scottish Government can't hold the same powers which are exercisable only after parliamentary approval. Their position simply makes no sense. The Scottish Government has listened to the committee's genuine concerns, ably put by Mr Rowley, made that distinction and has modified its thinking to a measured piece of legislation that will be on our statute when the time arises, and it will, that we need to break that glass in an emergency.
Thank you, Mr Farley. I now call on Miles Briggs to be followed by Katie Clark. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the time I have today, I wanted to concentrate my comments on part four of the bill, the wide-ranging powers, which were brought in during the pandemic, including the removal of eviction grounds, were supported as an emergency response to the pandemic. Now, we all want to see good and responsible landlords, and I believe a vast majority of landlords across Scotland are indeed responsible. It's obvious that in the interest of all parties, we need to make sure that they work to secure a tenancy, but also to support and sustain tenants when they're facing financial difficulties. If there's one thing we do know, and this is something which I think is important and hope ministers will listen to today, it is that changes in policy and interventions into the property market can often result in changes in behaviour by property owners and decisions being taken to remove properties from the rental market. As Michelle Thompson, I think, was pointing towards, a key concern is that the introduction of the proposals in Part 4 of this bill do not currently take into account the wider private rented sector and preempts and prejudges the outcomes of the Scottish Government's future housing bill and indeed, as has already been highlighted, the draft strategy and consultation around the New Deal for tenants as well. Housing policy in Scotland and indeed across the developed world is littered with unintended consequences, which the convener of the Local Government Committee highlighted. And I very much share those concerns over the possible loss of affordable homes for the rented market, which this bill could drive. Very briefly, yes.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. Can I put it to the member that this is a slight overreaction to the measures contained in this bill? Pre-action protocols are already standard practice and a requirement in the social rented sector, and we've been told that they are already best practice in the private rented sector. And as for making repossession ground is discretionary, none of that prevents any landlord from seeking repossession. It only means that their circumstances and their tenant's circumstances will all be taken into account when the decision is made.
I think the Minister maybe needs to take consideration of all the organisations and individuals who will be affected by these changes and who have put forward their real concerns. And the Government's response, the Deputy First Minister's response to our committee report, stretched to just 23 words of basically admitting that the Government acknowledged these concerns. But we've heard nothing today about that. Because consideration of single aspects of the private rented sector in complete isolation from the wider market do not allow for proper parliamentary scrutiny either of these proposals, and we've not seen that, sadly. We've not been able to do that as a committee. The housing crisis in Scotland is perhaps at its most vulnerable, however, in rural Scotland, and the potential impact which this bill could have on the supply and demand of rented properties in rural Scotland should be a real concern to all of us, including SNP and Green ministers, who do not seem to be taking these concerns as seriously as they should be. And these concerns are being expressed from across the rural sector, key stakeholders from Scotland Land and Estates, Scottish Association of Landlords, Scottish Property Federation, NFU Scotland, the Church of Scotland has already been touched upon, and individual landlords as well. And as stated in the Deputy First Minister's response to these organisations, they do believe that the Scottish Government is misusing COVID legislation to push through housing elements of the agreement between the SNP and Scottish Green parties. Now, a key component of the solution to the housing crisis in Scotland is the supply and improvement of homes to rent. Ministers have undertaken no work to consult or undertake impact assessment around this, and the sectors want to see that pause to be able to look and understand the potential situations which tenants will face, but also the unintended consequences. And given the increasing interest rates and cost of living crisis which we're seeing, the need for rental properties is essential, and any measures which could potentially be detrimental to the provision of these properties needs to be fully understood and considered. And that's something, sadly, I do not think this bill has achieved to date. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, the real concerning impact which Part 4 of the bill could have on the supply and potential removal of rental properties appears to not have been considered fully by the Scottish Government. I hope now that ministers, and we've heard them suggest this at stage two, will indeed pause and consider the real impact of the bill. Scottish Conservatives will be bringing forward amendments to Part 4 at stage two. I hope that's something we can see engagement across the chamber on. But it's important we do really consider these unintended consequences to the property market in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. I now call Katie Clark to be followed by Willie Coffey. Up to 5 minutes, please, Ms Clark.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm a member of the Criminal Justice Committee, so I'm going to focus on that aspect of the legislation. Audrey Nicholl, the convener of the committee, has obviously already spoken to the report. And the issues that I'm raising largely relate to process rather than fundamental principle, other than in relation to the extension in time limits, which I'll deal with later in my contribution. There are a number of provisions in this bill that will result in significant changes to the criminal justice system, some of which are complex. However, the committee was unable to scrutinise many of these measures in the bill in detail due to time restraints due to the truncated nature of this process. I believe it would have been more appropriate for some of these provisions to be brought forward as standalone legislation, which would have had a timetable to enable the full scrutiny process, particularly given that some of even the temporary measures are in place or could be in place until 2025. I'd like to focus on some specific aspects of the bill. The first is in relation to remote custody appearances, which the Scottish Government have indicated they wish to become the normal part of the justice system. And our understanding is that there is considerable concern within the legal profession and the wider justice system about these remote custody appearances, which were enabled by the previous COVID legislation and so therefore are currently operating. For example, in the Glasgow Custody Court last Monday, the court ran to 9:30 at night in the evening due to a range of technical problems. And I know that because my colleague Paul McNeill attended the court and witnessed what happened. We understand that this is far from an unusual occurrence, and in their evidence to the committee, both the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association and the Law Society of Scotland said that these appearances are often subject to technical problems. Concerns have also been raised about the greater difficulty in obtaining instructions from accused person by lawyers, and also by the Scottish Association of Social Workers, who have expressed their concern about access arrangements. These are significant changes to how the legal system operates in Scotland, and I do believe there are matters that this chamber and indeed the Criminal Justice Committee should have had the opportunity to find out a great deal more about. Another aspect that I would like to focus on is the issue of virtual trials. As the committee report has said, there is very little evidence that full virtual trials have in reality taken place, and therefore very little evidence as to how they are working. What is clear is that there's aspects of trials that have had virtual aspects. Therefore, for example, people give evidence by a virtual link, or indeed juries have been taking place in cinemas. But I would like to express my concern that indeed some of the undertakings that have been given by ministers, that there is an attempt to make sure that these trials only go ahead where all are agreed and that there's a proper scrutiny process in terms of how they operate. Perhaps the part of the bill that I think gives greatest concern in relation to justice and indeed to human rights concerns is the extension of time limits, which of course are already in place as a result of the emergency COVID legislation. This bill proposes that on a temporary basis, which of course could mean until 2025, that the statutory time limits, which have been in place on an emergency basis, are continued. There are some minor changes to them, but in general they're very similar to the emergency COVID legislation. That obviously means that it could be a far longer period of time until a case comes to court. Perhaps even more concerningly is that the time that a person can be held on remand is also being extended. So, for example, a person could be held on remand for 9 months until they are served with the indictment, which basically is the charges, the full charges that they will be facing. Scotland, of course, already has the highest remand and prison populations in Western Europe, along with poor overcrowded prisons in many parts of the estate. Between 2014 and 2017, 57.18% of prisoners who were later convicted in summary cases and 28.9% of prisoners who were later convicted in solemn cases did not receive a custodial sentence at the end of the proceedings. I think there's considerable human rights concerns about this aspect of the proceedings. There would never be a situation where somebody that should be in prison should be there, because there, of course, is always provision in Scots law on cause
Please conclude.
Concern for cases to have time limits extended. But I do believe these are fundamental issues that the Chamber needs to be concerned about today. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Willie Coffey, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. Our local government committee focused its attention on tenancy issues considered in Part 4 of the Bill, and the whole committee was content to support the proposals by the Scottish Government, including our Tory and Labour colleagues who supported it then but are going to vote against it in 20 minutes or so. Very curious indeed. There are two key proposals in the Bill in relation to private sector tenancies: to retain those temporary measures introduced to protect tenants from eviction during the COVID period. One is to continue to make all eviction cases that go to the Housing and Property Chamber of the First Tier Tribunal discretionary, rather than mandatory as they were pre-COVID. And the other is in requiring landlords to carry out pre-action protocols concerning grounds for evictions due to rent arrears. For what I hope are clear and obvious reasons, those measures were necessary during COVID to help protect people from eviction from their tenancy in the private rented sector during a major health pandemic. And the Scottish Government is asking Parliament to agree to retain those measures. All eviction grounds have been discretionary in the social rented sector now for around 20 years, and the proposal to retain this within the private rented sector basically aligns both sectors and continues that level of protection for tenants. It has meant a fairer approach for tenants, and it balances the needs of tenants and landlords a bit more. Shelter certainly backs both proposals. In their submission for members, describes the measures as important and progressive, which will help support tenants to keep their homes wherever possible, and it will prevent homelessness. Remember too that the discretionary element doesn't prevent landlords from pursuing an eviction should that be necessary, and that point was well made during our committee's work, but it does provide that additional comfort that circumstances must be taken into account before a decision is taken. Now, it's fair to say that during our evidence, some landlords were concerned by the measure, and some fear that landlords with perhaps a single or only a few properties might opt to leave the sector altogether. But Matt Downey from Crisis argued that the issue isn't about whether landlords will or won't leave the sector, but simply that the discretionary element allows the support needs of both the tenants and the landlords to be taken into account, which was never the case before. He described it as a common sense move that could be to everybody's advantage. The Minister also commented that the measure does not fundamentally alter the rights of landlords, but provides that fairer balance of rights for everyone. And the Government, in its response to our committee's report, has given us an assurance that it will liaise with the Tribunal to monitor eviction cases going forward. Part 4 of the Bill, Presiding Officer, also retains the pre-action protocol provisions that have been in place in the social rented sector too for some time. What these basically mean are things like having clear information on a tenancy, the level of arrears that are in question, stating the rights of the tenant, signposting to support and advice, landlords making a reasonable effort to agree a payment plan with a tenant, and giving reasonable consideration to any steps a tenant has taken to address their situation are all recommended. Although these steps aren't mandatory in themselves, the Tribunal can take this into account and consider whether a landlord has complied with the protocol before granting a decree for eviction. The Scottish Association of Landlords don't have any objection to this measure and say that the measures represent what they have always considered to be best practice anyway, where landlords try to engage with tenants, try to help them overcome the problems and ultimately sustain their tenancy. Presiding Officer, there haven't been many positives coming out of the whole COVID experience for anybody. We can cite, and it has been cited today, the deployment of digital technology in a number of settings, not least here in this place, to allow this place to continue to function, and in many other areas too, where online meant people could stay in a job, continue to do business, and it has been a revelation to many of us about how we can work in the future. But these two measures in Part 4, brought in temporarily to try and protect people from eviction during a public health emergency, have been particularly helpful too, I think, and are worthy of retaining on a permanent basis now. I hope the Parliament agrees the principles of the Bill at Stage 1, and these measures are an important part of that. Protecting people who face eviction by supporting both tenants and landlords is a worthy inclusion in any Bill in front of the Parliament, and I'm happy to support the Bill today. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to winding up speeches, and I call on Alex Rowley. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, in closing for Labour in today's debate, I want to restate the point I made to John Swinney at committee, and that is, with the Green Party, the SNP can force this legislation through, but in doing so, I believe we will have another bit of poor legislation that without doubt removes powers from this Parliament into the hands of the Executive. I have listened carefully to what Mr Swinney said today, and I will address that. I also want to restate the point I made that there is much within the wide-ranging Bill that is good and has support, as we have saw from the evidence sessions of all the committees who heard evidence on different aspects of the Bill. I say this Bill is wide-ranging, and I would suggest it is too wide-ranging, and to do justice and come up with good legislation that will address the issues that require attention, we as a Parliament should have the time and the space that is needed. Take justice as an example. There is no doubt that the pandemic has caused major problems, but it is also clear there were major problems before the pandemic that required action. As Katie Clark has said, the fact that Scotland has the highest remand and prison population figures in Western Europe, along with poor, overcrowded conditions in many prisons, should be a concern across this chamber. But is putting legislation into a catch-all COVID recovery bill the best approach to this? I think not, and I note from the report of the Criminal Justice Committee that they say time and again in the report that they had limited time to scrutinise this bill. Then let me turn to education. I have to say, as a dyed of four grandchildren, and then five, dyed means granddad, but as a dyed of four grandchildren, I really worry about the impact that COVID has had on education and the downward spiral that we saw pre-COVID. And the changes for education in this bill gives me no confidence that this government is even beginning to get on top of the issues in education. So I do conclude this bill will do little to aid the recovery and reform of Scottish education that is desperately needed at this time. We must do more to rebuild education in Scotland, and that must be a priority. I want now to turn to the parts of the bill considered by the COVID-19 Recovery Committee, and there were many positive aspects discussed in looking at the evidence. However, there is one part of this bill that is for me, and I hope for this Parliament, a red line, and that is the so-called Henry VIII power. I have to say that when I first heard Murdo Fraser talk about a power grab, I did think that was a bit rich. But the more I looked at the evidence, the more I realised this was a proposal to remove powers from this Parliament, the legislator, and put them into the hands of ministers, the executive. And you can frame it however you like, but it is to remove power from the democratically elected Parliament into the hands of ministers. And that is not acceptable, not acceptable under any circumstances, and we need to address that. The written submissions from Dr Andrew Tickle and Professor Alison Britton of Glasgow Caledonian University states that they conclude the main provisions in Part 1 of the Bill are generally in keeping with the law already applying in England and Wales and will establish a more flexible and resilient framework for coordinating the public health response to any future health emergencies. And that is good. But they then go on to say, as currently drafted, the bill includes one highly problematic element which has not been adequately explained or justified by the Scottish Government. The Henry VIII power empowered the then King to make law without reference to the English Parliament in 1539. And now in 2022, the SNP want to do similar, to take powers from this Parliament. As Tickle in Britain put it, while powers of this kind have been used by the UK Government to adapt the statute book to the United Kingdom's departure from the European Union, Henry VIII's powers are rightly controversial as they infringe upon the separation of powers, give legislative functions to the executive and can be imposed with modest opportunities for parliamentary scrutiny, particularly in circumstances when they are used on an emergency basis. So whilst I welcome what Mr Swinney had to say and will study closely what he had to say, I ask the government to think again on what is certainly for Labour a red line. And in doing so, I acknowledge there is much support for aspects of this bill, no more so than from Crisis Scotland, whose brief I read this morning, making a very strong case for Part 4 of this bill. So let us work together to build the future. Let's look at where we can find compromise and move forward in this Parliament to build a better future for Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Jamie Green, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Right at the beginning of the pandemic, this chamber came together in good faith to respond to the very real and severe threat that the pandemic posed each and every one of us. Lives were at risk, and we had to act, and we had to act fast. Of course, we didn't get everything right as legislators, but I think we can be proud of the fact that we did act quickly, nimbly, and mostly constructively when needed, from stage one right through to royal assent in record time. The First Minister herself, though, has stated that the current direction of travel is to get back to normality as quickly as possible, whilst maintaining vigilance against future outbreaks. The COVID Recovery Secretary, Deputy First Minister Mr Swinney, said, "We want to ensure we remove measures no longer needed in order to respond to the pandemic, whilst keeping those that were there to demonstrable benefit to the people of Scotland." Vigilance, I think, is prudent. I don't disagree. And I don't disagree with the thrust of Mr Swinney's argument still that some of the adaptations to the delivery of public services, such as digitisation, were useful. Frankly, some of them should have happened sooner. But now they're here, some might be here to stay. We all accept that. But our argument has been that this bill, as drafted to us, goes far too far, contains measures which are frankly no longer necessary and not of demonstrable benefit, to use Mr Swinney's phrase. He also used the phrase that this bill is necessary, proportionate and appropriate. And it is those three words I want us all to be mindful as we go through this process. Yes, of course some of the measures we took in the past may be necessary in the future. Of course some of the powers that we gave government in that scenario may be appropriate as well when needed. But proportionality is a whole other ballgame. Now, it's been called a power grab by many, but I think that oversimplifies what is actually quite a grave attempt by government to retain extraordinary powers. The previous Parliament, which many of us here were part of, were cautiously uneasy about affording the government these powers in the first place. We did it because we had to, but at no time was there any suggestion at all that we would be asked to be given the government these powers on a permanent basis. Anything but. And it's quite depressing that today the parliamentary arithmetic will probably result in this bill passing anyway, ignoring the many concerns that have been voiced in this building and out with. My colleague Murdo Fraser rightly pointed out the depth of concern started right back at the consultation process. Right back in the consultation process. And then the report which the committee produced. There's one phrase jumped out at me, and that was this. The Scottish Government has not made a sufficient case for why these powers should be made permanent. It had not made sufficient case then, and it still has not made sufficient case. The committee heard there were viable alternatives to the so-called Henry VIII powers, including, for example, the removing of the provisions entirely until a public health emergency actually arises. That would give Parliament a proper say, for example, by passing new emergency laws. We did it before. I ask, why cannot we be trusted to do it again? That's a point Jackie Bailey made, Alex Cole-Hamilton made, and many others. A question that is equally yet to be answered by the government. And it's not just politicians who have concerns about this. The Law Society warned that these powers have the potential to result in real significant reduction and restrictions on liberty being imposed through regulations, reduced opportunity for parliamentary oversight and scrutiny. They said the bill creates a risk of misuse or the powers being used worse, in error. And I'm afraid to say that the use and the inclusion of these powers is simply not reflected in equivalent legislation in other parts of the UK, no matter what we've heard today. In fact, the suggestion that they do is, in a second, is not just unhelpful, but it's misleading. And let me explain why there are differences, because as drafted, this bill says that it includes the power to modify or amend any enactment, any piece of legislation. Ministers want that power. That power is not found elsewhere. It's simply not. And that's a point I'll have to give away in a second. There's another point of the UK legislation, and that is one that is very deeply personal to me, and that is the ability to give ministers the ability to remove early release and to reduce people's prison sentences. It's unended and unlimited, for example, in the Scottish Bill. In the UK Bill, it's capped to 180 days. Quite a sensible move. Now, of course, we'll give the government the benefit of the doubt. Let's see what the stage two amendments are in that respect. But I will reflect on this. The affirmative procedure is not the same as the three-stage process that legislation goes through, which is so sacrosanct to us in a unicameral environment such as this. In fact, I would go as far as say as regulations are simple vote majorities, and they're also victims to the whims of political majorities, such as was the case with the EU Continuity Bill, another so-called emergency law. As I said, there are some sensible and reasonable justice-related provisions, which I do support, but there are others which we don't. The virtual trials have been widely condemned by many. The senators of the Colleges of Justice said that videos by video hearings should not become the norm. They say that the dignity and solemnity of the courtroom are missing in a video conference. The Faculty Advocates, the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association and many others have raised many concerns about this. The main one I want to raise briefly is that of early release. That power was used in emergency situations. There were 348 people granted early release under these powers. The front benches might want to hear this. Of those 348, 142 reoffended within 6 months after early release. That should be a statistical alarm bell in each and every one of our ears right now. I'm afraid that's not a risk that these benches are willing to take, to be quite frank. The committee was also divided on relations to fiscal fines and many other things.
But in conclusion, Mr. Green,
I want the government to think about two final things. Nothing in this feels very consensual, I'm afraid. Listening to the speeches, the conveners are split in their reports. The casting votes should have been the warning signs. But the second and the most important one is I urge the government to take cognizance of today's debate. The speeches today were so powerful in their combined attempt to protect the sanctity of the separation of powers of Parliament and Executive. Let's not cross that line on a permanent basis. We do so at our peril.
Thank you. I call on Hamza Youssef to wind up the debate. Up to 8 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As the Cabinet Secretary responsible for part one of the bill, both public protection measures, public health protection proposals and indeed arrangements for vaccination and immunisation, I'm pleased to close this debate for the government. This has been an interesting debate, not only touching on public health policy, but of course many other aspects of the bill. I hope to spend most of the time trying to address some of those points that have been made. But let me say from the offset that the Deputy First Minister, myself and of course other government ministers and Cabinet Secretaries will continue to engage both with members of this Parliament but also with important stakeholders in advance of the parliamentary processes that the bill still has to go through. Can I thank the five scrutiny committees work at stage one, supported of course by full and very thoughtful briefings from both external stakeholders but also of course from SPICE as well. As Siobhan Brown, convener of the lead COVID-19 Recovery Committee, has said, no stone was left unturned in the government's no stone was left unturned in scrutiny of these proposals. In the government's view, that demonstrates the Parliament's adeptness at scrutinising longer, more complex and cross-portfolio bills. We remain of the view that it was best to group the range of proposals consulted on into a single bill intended for commencement from September of this year. Following on from the government's response to stage one reports at the beginning of this week, there's been a full debate in our position on stage two amendments. I've listened carefully to all the points that have been made. I hope for those members who often use the term railroading legislation or bulldozing legislation, I hope they will have listened carefully to what the Deputy First Minister actually said about the compromises we are willing to make. Those compromises, undoubtedly, anybody's objective view on those compromises would be that we are wanting Parliament, I will in just a second, we are wanting to give Parliament further scrutiny over this bill and over these emergency powers. Of course, I'll give way to Jamie Green.
Jamie Green.
One area of consensus that the government could agree to is to take the good bits of the bill where there is consensus across the chamber, package that up as a piece of legislation which we will pass and agree to, and ditch the bits which are the hugely controversial bits which actually protect the primacy and sanctity of this Parliament.
Cabinet Secretary.
I was going to come to this point. The trouble, if I can respond, and then I will give way to that point. What I would say to Jamie Green, of course, is if we did that, then the emergency powers, which are required to respond in quick speed, not simply to take legislation off a shelf that might be inadequate for the particular pandemic or emergency we are dealing with, and therefore we would have to enact emergency legislation, that would take days. And I can tell you, as a Cabinet Secretary for Health, who is dealing with this immediate pandemic, that every day counts. We cannot afford to do that. Of course, I give way to my friend, Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And this goes back to the point I was trying to raise with Jamie Green, and I accept you didn't have time to take the intervention. But Andrew Tickell has today made this statement. Most of what this bill does to extend the powers which already exist on a permanent basis in England and Wales under the 1984 Public Health Act of Scotland on a permanent basis, which seems unobjectionable to me. Sandish Gohani asked for a 90-minute debate in order to release the bills that are going to be held in situ. Surely, if you want something packaged up, those kinds of measures taken by the government would give you what you were looking for.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, and that is the very point. These powers do exist in England and Wales. They have sweeping powers. The UK government has sweeping and widespread powers over public protection, public health protection. And what we are suggesting is that we also have powers in emergency, but that we not only provide a statement of why those powers, emergency powers, emergency regulations should be enacted, but of course that the Parliament authorises that. So anybody suggesting that the government could impose a lockdown without Parliament's authorisation hasn't listened to what the Deputy First Minister has said. So let me read again exactly what we are proposing. And I appreciate entirely that the devil will be in the detail. You will want to look and examine that amendment closely. That is absolutely appropriate. But let me just read again what it is that we are proposing. To ensure that necessary parliamentary oversight is in place, the government will bring forward amendments to introduce a gateway vote mechanism, which would mean that key aspects of the public health protection and education continuity powers would only have effect if a parliamentary vote on a formal government declaration is held and approved. This would allow Parliament to enact these powers with the confidence that lockdown, school closures and other emergency response measures could only be imposed in the event of a future public health threat in an emergency situation if the Parliament has so authorised. So this is the critical point. And of course, again, I reiterate that we respect the fact that the Parliament will want to see the detail of those amendments at stage two. But I would ask members to do so in good faith. And if they did so in good faith, they would not be voting against the general principles of this bill at stage one. There was some... Yes, I will give way.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very, very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. You and I have had this conversation before, Cabinet Secretary, as with the Deputy First Minister. Surely the pandemic highlighted the shortcomings in the NHS IT system and education system and data gathering and usage, and also we allowed the Silver Swan recommendations to slide. Surely it's in the readiness and preparedness that we need to be focusing on, and that would have had the desired effect on helping us with future emergencies. I don't see anything in that within the government, the government proposals.
I would say to Brian Whittle, I have the greatest respect for him, that he needs to read the bill carefully, because the powers about preparedness are one of the key aspects of this bill. Yeah, the emergency powers are the other part, but preparedness, again, similar to what the UK government has already, those powers are powers that we are seeking through this bill. A number of issues were raised in and around the justice provisions, and I thought Audrey Nicol in particular made very powerful arguments around some of the disagreements that we know that exist in relation to virtual trials, and that's why I think the approach the government is taking is a sensible one. These powers, of course, are in there temporarily, and of course we have consultations, one of which actually launched today, in relation to some of the justice provisions, and we will bring forward our thoughts on the back of those consultations. I thought Katie Clark spoke very well, very powerfully about the human rights implications and aspects in relation to the time limits. I will continue to give her and my colleague, Cabinet Secretary for Justice, will continue to give this Parliament very strong assurances, of course, that that is why these powers are temporary. We understand those human rights implications, that these measures are only being brought forward and extended at this point to reduce that backlog, which in itself, of course, that backlog has huge human rights implications and impacts, again, on many men and indeed women right across Scotland. In relation to some of the other points that were made on education, all I will say in that respect, and the question was asked by Stephen Kerr, by a number of other members across the chamber, is we are continuing our engagement. We have had continual engagement, both as officials, but also the Cabinet Secretary for Education. I know my colleague Shirley-Ann Somerville met with University of Scotland and Colleges Scotland as recently as the 4th of May. So we'll keep Parliament updated. And of course, we're considering what the universities, what colleges, COSLA, the EIS and others have to say in advance of stage two. I do not have much time at all to go into the detail of general the issues raised around tenancies. I thought my colleague Patrick Harvey, but also Willie Coffey, made those points really well, that all these the provisions do, they simply enable a tribunal to take into account all of the circumstances relating to a case before making a decision. I thought the points raised by Murdo Fraser around the concerns of the Church of Scotland were ones that we will reflect further on ahead of stage two. So I will sum up, Presiding Officer, simply by saying on the so-called Henry VIII power, and further and perhaps more significantly, the addition of a gateway vote mechanism for any future regulations of an emergency nature, I hope that those provisions give some comfort to the Parliament. I hope collectively these amendments give members and parties assurances that they can vote for the general principles of this bill. Presiding Officer, I invite the Parliament to vote to learn the lessons of the pandemic, to complete the statute book and to put in place that resilience for whatever challenges may come in the years ahead.
Thank you. That concludes the stage one debate on Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of motion 4263 in the name of Kate Forbes on a financial resolution for the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. And I call on Kate Forbes to move the motion.
It moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of motions 4335 to 4338 in the name of Kate Forbes on appointments to the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And I call on Kate Forbes to move the motions.
They're moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The questions on these motions will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 4375 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on Stage 2 timetable. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on Stephen Kerr to move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. No member is asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 4375 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 4310 in the name of John Swinney on Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote. There will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.